first half of the 20th century, came up with the names of Gershwin, Rodgers and Hart, Irving Berlin, Cole Porter, all really big names in musical theater. And then, so starting with that, wanted to look at some of the shows that, that these creative teams had made that didn't do so well, and came up with this list of shows that we're gonna talk about tonight. The first, Gershwin's Strike Up the Band. There were two versions, 27 and 30, and we'll talk a little bit more about that. Rodgers and Hart's The Boys from Syracuse, Irving Berlin's Miss Liberty, and we'll end with Cole Porter's Out of This World. For each of the slides, I've included footnotes here on where South Bay Musical Theater has had productions of these shows over the years. And of these four shows that we're talking about tonight, only The Boys from Syracuse has been produced on the South Bay Musical Theater stage, and that was in 1984. So these are the four shows that we're gonna talk about this evening. We're gonna go through them in chronological order. And so let's get started with the first of our shows, Strike Up the Band, the George and Ira Gershwin show. For each of the shows too, we'll talk again about the context of the overall creative canon of the composer and lyricist team. If we think about the stage works of Ira and George Gershwin, here is the list going from 1924's Lady Be Good all the way up to Porgy and Bess at 1935. The show Strike Up the Band is sort of the later end of their creative works. It's been described as a wonderful score that was sadly neglected during the Depression. And you'll see, I mean, the dates of 27 and 30 are right about the start of the Depression as well. And that tells a lot about the story of Strike Up the Band and kind of what happened with it as well. George and Ira Gershwin, very well known in early musical theater. They were brothers born in Brooklyn to an immigrant Russian Jewish family. Ira, the shorter of the two in the picture at the side, was the more academically inclined of the two. He attended a public high school for intellectually gifted students and then attended the City College of New York. George, the younger brother, was not so academically inclined and dropped out of school at age 15. He loved playing piano though, and continued playing piano, both classical and pop, even after he dropped out of school. He became a Tin Pan Alley songwriter, had his first song published at 15, and then in the early 20s, started publishing orchestral music, things like Rhapsody in Blue and American in Paris. They're known for their, I mean, wonderful melodic songs and creative lyrics. And I'd like to start the first musical selection by playing a song from Strike Up the Band titled The Man I Love. And I explicitly picked a song sung by the great Ella Fitzgerald. And Ella recorded a lot of the songbook songs, not only from the Gershwins, but a lot of the greats from the early musical theater. Kind of definitive recordings of many of them. And it's those recordings that Ella made in the 50s that really helped spur my interest in early musical and some of these lesser known musicals as well. So let's start by listening to a recording of Ella Fitzgerald from Strike Up the Band, singing the song, The Man I Love.
Someday he'll come along, the man I love, and he'll be big and strong, the man I love. And when he comes my way, I'll do my best to make him stay. He'll look at me and smile, I'll understand.
Fitzgerald singing The Man I Love. That's a recording from 1959. As I mentioned, the show was originally written in 1927. It didn't make it to Broadway until 1930. I'd like to talk a little bit about what happened then. So 1927, the environment was very different than the environment of 1930. And that is really important for understanding the story of this show as well. The environment in 1927, we're in the middle of the Roaring Twenties. World War I is over, and there's a tremendous amount of nationalistic pride in the country. There was economic exuberance. The market was booming. People were working, earning lots of money and spending it like there was no tomorrow. It was the time of prohibition, but there were speakeasies and kind of people out to have a good time. The public was having a love affair with Broadway in the late 1920s as well. 1927 was a particularly great year for Broadway, with some 300 shows on Broadway in that year alone, including 51 musicals. 300 shows, that's pretty amazing. By comparison, in 1972, there were only 50 shows on Broadway. So it was quite an exuberant time for the theater and for America in general. Strike Up the Band had an amazing creative team. It was not just the Gershwins, who were already quite well known, but it was based on a book and libretto by George F. Kaufman, born in 1889. He was a playwright, director, producer, critic, and humorist. Even in the early 20s, he had written two books for Marx Brother vehicles, The Coconuts and Animal Crackers. He was widely considered the inventor of the wisecrack, a member of the Algonquin Round Table. He has a huge list of credits. He's a frequent collaborator of Maury Riskin and Moss Hart, whose names we'll hear about more. He had won two Pulitzer Prizes, one for his collaboration with Gershwin's on their later musical of The I Sing from 1932, and won a Tony Award for the best direction of Guys and Dolls in 51. So a pretty amazing team overall. This was also a highly innovative musical for its time as well. It was Gershwin's first fully integrated score for a book musical, where the songs actually helped advance the plot. The songs were customized to the characters and the dramatic situation. This was not the case for most of the shows in the 1920s. Earlier musicals, one critic wrote, couldn't tell a legitimate story that wasn't an excuse for jokes, interchangeable love ballads, or a star turn. Situations didn't cry out for songs. Songs were written, which then required situations. And these situations were dropped into the plot line like landmines into a cornfield. So this was quite different from a lot of what had preceded it. And it was also innovative in that it was a political satire, which was not common in musical theater. Major themes of the show included leaders starting war for their own self-importance, mindless patriotism and flag waving, and suppression of unpopular views in the name of patriotism. It predates the show The Cradle Will Rock that we talked about in Heather Kenyon's Broadway by the Decades. The Cradle Will Rock, which was a major musical dealing with issues of labor and labor versus the corporations. That play was from 1937, so 10 years later than Strike Up the Band. Perhaps the best known song from Strike Up the Band is the title song, and let's listen to that next. This is from the 1940 movie Strike Up the Band, featuring Judy Garland and Mickey Rooney. So let's listen to Strike Up the Band.
Let the drums roll out, let the trumpet call, while the people shout, strike up the band. Hear the cymbals ring, calling one and all, to that happy swing, strike up the band. Yankee doo-doo-doo-doo-doo, we'll come through, Yankee doo-doo-doo, for the red, white, blue-doo-doo, let the hands, let the flag unfurl. We can face the world. Hey, lead us back up the band.
Let the drum roll on. Let the trumpets call. While the people shout, back up the band. Hear the cymbals ring, calling one and all.
So this was one of four musicals that Judy Garland and Mickey Rooney filmed in the late 30s and early 40s. It followed Babes in Arms, and the plot of the movie version, Strike Up the Band, was very similar to Babes in Arms. It's the kids wanting to put on a show. Most of their musicals had that common theme to them as well. That song that we just heard, Strike Up the Band, is the only piece of the musical, the stage musical, that was part of the movie. All the other songs and the plot were completely different from the stage version of Strike Up the Band. The plot of the 1927 version, stage version of Strike Up the Band, revolves around a shady business tycoon. His name is Horace J. Fletcher, and he is a cheese manufacturer. He secretly uses inferior milk in the production of his American cheese. His principal competition is Switzerland. Switzerland makes Swiss cheese, and he has convinced Washington to impose a steep tariff on Swiss cheese to protect his American cheese empire. He then continues to incite widespread nationalistic fervor against the Swiss, and then eventually convinces Washington to declare war on Switzerland. And in the process, he makes a deal with Washington. He claims all naming rights to the war, which becomes the Horace J. Fletcher Memorial War. In exchange, he gives the government he promises the government 25% of the profits from the war. There's a line in the musical, "We cannot maintain our neutrality any longer. We are declaring war. We'll find a reason later." Fletcher has a daughter who falls in love with a newspaper man who tries to expose the truth about the inferiority of the Fletcher cheese, but the public doesn't want to hear it. There's this nationalistic fervor. He eventually helps win the war against the Swiss and is vindicated and wins the girl in the end. But it is, again, the underlying feeling of business corruption and unjustified war was very different from, you know, what we had seen in Broadway prior to this show. And part of the reason it had a bit of a challenge. The show had tryouts in Philadelphia in 1927. And although the critics loved it, they also said there wasn't a chance for the musical either. They said this is not what audiences were expecting on the stage, and said that it was too close on the heels of World War I. A local newspaper wrote, "Satirical musicals have never been a success in America, nor do Americans like to be laughed at on the stage." Kaufman, who wrote the book and libretto, was famously quoted as saying, "Satire is what closes on Saturday night." I'm not sure he entirely believed that, because he collaborated with the Gershwin team on two other satirical musicals, Of Thee I Sing and Let Him Eat Cake, in the next couple of years as well. But it's a quote frequently attributed to him. The show did not do well. It closed in Philadelphia after just 2 weeks, and it took it until 1930 for it to appear on the stage in Broadway. Broadway looked very different in 1930 than it did in 1927. We talked about the exuberance of Broadway in 1927. By 1930, we were at the start of the Great Depression. In 1929, the fall of 1929, the market crashed. There were bread lines. The country was not in good shape economically. People didn't have disposable income. So it was a very different economic situation. And we also had stage productions competing with film in a way they hadn't before. The jazz singer, the first talkie from 1927, had paved the way for a floodgate of new talkies in the theaters. So they were severely competing with what was happening on the stage. By 1931, two-thirds of the theaters in Manhattan had closed from that peak in 1927. The show took some major work to get it prepared for 1930 and the change in popular sentiment as to what was expected on stage, and in adapting more jazz and swing, which were very popular musical styles as well. Kaufman had lost interest in the show, and so they brought in his friend Maury Riskin to do a major rewrite on the show to get it ready for Broadway. Riskin commented it was like rewriting War and Peace for the Three Stooges. And in fact, the version that appeared in 1930 was very different from the 1927 version. It included as principal actors Bobby Clark and Paul McCullough, who were circus performers and vaudevillians, who kind of turned it into more of a slapstick show. All of the war sequences were put into a dream sequence in the 1930 version of the play. So it didn't have the same biting satire that the original had. Most critics argue that the 1927 version is far superior to the 1930 version. In addition to that, the Clark and McCullough team, the orchestra for Strike Up the Band included some big band noted names as well. Jimmy Dorsey, Benny Goodman, Gene Krupa, and Glenn Miller all performed in the orchestra for Strike Up the Band as well. If we look at the competition for Strike Up the Band, so when it opened in 1930, it had major competition from two Cole Porter shows, from a Rodgers and Hart show, and also from Gershwin's own Girl Crazy that they were preparing to launch later in 1930 as well, which included a lot more jazz, which was the current trend for a lot of their creative writing, a show that featured Ginger Rogers and was the vehicle for Ethel Merman's debut. So a lot had changed between 27 and 30. It was a very different environment. And in 1930, Strike Up the Band had some real competition as well. But there have been no Broadway revivals of Strike Up the Band. It does have some amazing music. So the 1930 version actually has quite a bit different music than the 1927 version. And there have been a number of attempts to try to update the two versions. I want to play two more selections. This will be the end for Strike Up the Band. One is, they're both related to war. The first is a very satirical song called "Oh, This Is Such a Lovely War." And then we'll end with the song "Homeward Bound," a beautiful ballad. So two more songs from the show Strike Up the Band by the Gershwins.
This is such a lovely war. Oops, what a lovely war. Oops, what a lovely war. It keeps you out in the old realm there. Well, this is such a lovely war. Oops, what a lovely war. Oops, what a lovely war. We're glad that we're over here, over there.
Oh boy, we get three meals a day and all our clothing free.
At 5 o'clock the sergeant comes and takes us out for tea.
We can't be fired because we've got a 2-year guarantee.
Songs from the show Strike Up the Band. Oh, This Is Such a Lovely War was from a 1990 studio recording from the restored version of the score. And Homeward Bound was a studio recording from a 2019 London production of Strike Up the Band. Sarah, I'll stop for a second, see if there are questions about this before we move on to our next show, Boys from Syracuse.
Ron, we don't have any particular questions, just lots of comments about the historical, both the Busby Berkeley choreographed numbers, as well as just the American Songbook that are all reflected in here.
Yeah. And it's hard to even find a definitive score from a lot of these early shows because they have been rewritten. Revivals are rewritten. And this one, basically the shows were very different between 27 and 30 as well. Let's move on and talk about our next show. So Rodgers and Hart's The Boys from Syracuse. And this, again, is the one of the four shows that we're talking about this evening where there has been a South Bay musical theater production. It was from 1984. Unfortunately, don't have any pictures from that. Talking about Rodgers and Hart, so they were a very prolific team together, starting with their show Fly With Me in 1920 and their last show By Jupiter in 1942. Boys from Syracuse is one of their later shows. Talk a little bit of biographical about the two men. Richard Rodgers, born in 1902 to a prosperous German Jewish family in Queens. He was taken to Broadway a lot as a child, loved operetta and musicals. He attended Columbia University, as did both of his major librettists. Both Lorenz Hart and Oscar Hammerstein also attended Columbia. Rodgers and Hart started working together in 1919. They struggled initially. Their first big hit was a show, the song Manhattan, from the show The Garrett Gaieties of 1925. And we'll talk a little bit about that more. Richard Rodgers is the first of 16 people ever to win an EGOT. That is winning an Emmy, a Grammy, an Oscar, and Tony. He, in fact, has 2 Grammys and 6 Tonys. So the first of 16 people to be EGOTed or win an EGOT. He also had won a Pulitzer Prize for South Pacific in 1950, making him only one of 2 people ever to get an EGOT and a Pulitzer, the other being Marvin Hamlisch. So a little bit of trivia there for you. We'll talk a little bit about Lorenz Hart. It's kind of hard to talk about Lorenz Hart without comparing him to Hammerstein, the other major librettist of Richard Rodgers. Hammerstein's lyrics were known for their warmth, their sincerity and optimism. They're often called a bit corny. Hart, in contrast, showed a lot of wit, technical sophistication, and this kind of urban sensibility with some really kind of clever rhyming schemes. And I've included here 2 different sections from 2 of his songs. We mentioned Manhattan from the Garrett Gaieties on the previous slide. The lyrics there, I'll just read them for you. Summer journeys to Niagara and to other places aggravate all our cares. We'll save our fares. I have a cozy little flat in what was known as Old Manhattan. We'll settle down right here in town. Definitely not Hammerstein kind of lyrics, very much a New York focused as well. Lyrics from the song To Keep My Love Alive from their Connecticut Yankee. I married many men, a ton of them, because I wasn't true to none of them, because I bumped off every one of them to keep our love alive. Sir Thomas played the harp, I cussed the thing. I crowned him with the harp to bust the thing. And now he plays where harps are just the thing to keep my love alive. Again, clever, witty, very unlike what lyrics from Hammerstein. Lorenz Hart was born in Harlem of German Jewish immigrant family. The creative team also included George Abbott. George Abbott, another New Yorker born in 1887, was a producer, director, playwright, screenwriter, film producer, and director. This was his 19th Broadway production. He had previously collaborated with Rodgers and Hart on their 1935 Jumbo and their 1936 On Your Toes. He too has a number of awards, including a Pulitzer for Fiorello. He had 6 Tony Awards. And the creative team was filled out by George Balanchine, the 1904 Russian-born dancer, choreographer, actor, and director, founder of New York City Ballet, who also had collaborated with Rodgers and Hart previously on their 1936 On Your Toes, 1937 Babes in Arms, and 1938 I Married an Angel. So lots and lots of history with this team and a lot of anticipation for a wildly successful collaboration with this show as well. Oh, here we have pictures of George Abbott and George Balanchine as well. To understand the story, we'll talk a little bit about how it came to be. The story is based on a William Shakespeare play, the 1594 play, A Comedy of Errors. It was a kind of an unusual choice at the time. Richard Rodgers is quoted as saying the mere fact that it had never been done before was enough for us to start thinking about Shakespeare for their next project. Lorenz Hart was a big Shakespeare fan. And part of them picking this particular Shakespeare play is, the rumor has that his brother, Teddy Hart, was an actor and comedian and was frequently mistaken on stage by another actor named Jimmy Savo. The idea of having these two actors that people got confused into the Shakespeare play that involves twins that are confused seemed like a perfect fit for Rodgers and Hart. And so there we go. It is the first of a lot of musicals that have been inspired by the work of Shakespeare. Here are a few, some of the widely recognized, you know, Kiss Me Kate, West Side Story. There are others that are perhaps not so obvious. There's some debate about whether The Lion King is in fact a takeoff on Hamlet, but others that are very, very directly linked to the works of Shakespeare, in fact, go by the same Shakespeare titles. For those of you that don't know the details of the plot of Comedy of Errors, it's perhaps easier to show it than to describe it. So I have a couple of slides kind of describing or showing the plot of the story. We're set in ancient times in the Mediterranean, where we have the Roman and the Greek empires, Roman shown in gold, the Greek empire shown in purple. The whole plot revolves around two cities of Syracuse in the Roman Empire and Ephesus in the Greek Empire. The two cities do not get along, and there is a penalty of death for people traveling from one city to the other. A little bit of context. So before the show starts, we have a Roman family. Mom and dad have identical twins, or this is musical comedy. Both of the twins have the same name. The identical twins are both named Antipholus for reasons that we don't quite understand. And the family has acquired a set of identical twin slaves to take care of the boys. And both of the slave boys are named Dromio. The whole family goes out for a sailing trip in the Mediterranean. The ship capsizes and the family is separated. Half the family ends up in Ephesus in the Greek territory and half returns home to Rome. So this all happens before the show starts. We end up years later, everybody in Ephesus. We have both Antipholus and their slaves, Dromio, ending up in Ephesus, but not knowing the other is there. The mother is there. The father comes looking for his children and his wife and ends up letting the folks of Ephesus know that he's from Syracuse, and he's sentenced to death for going against that edict of traveling to the other city. So that's kind of the start of the show. To make it more complicated, the two gentlemen of Ephesus, Antipholus and his slave Dromio, both have wives, and the wives don't know that the men are identical twins either. And so there's this amazing comedy of everybody getting confused as to who is who, and a lot of mistaken identities. I'm gonna play next a song where Antipholus and Dromio from Syracuse sing when they first arrive in Ephesus. Let me see if I can open. This is from a 2007 stage production at Northwestern University, my alma mater.
Though we've worn out sandals and our funds are low, there's a light that's burning in the patio. I wanna go back to dear old Syracuse. It is no metropolis, it has no big Acropolis, and yet there is a quorum of cuties in the forum. Though the men wear jackets that are out of style, they will always read you with a friendly smile. I wanna go back to dear old Syracuse.
So there we have the two boys from Syracuse singing that they're homesick. The competition, other productions or other shows that were on the stage in Broadway at the time Boys from Syracuse opened, I Married an Angel, another Rodgers and Hart show, and Porter's Leave It to Me. It performed pretty well. I mean, there were, for 235 performances was not bad for the time. There was one revival of The Boys from Syracuse, 2000, a Broadway revival, 2002, with Chip Zeehan. The original cast, however, included Eddie Albert. You may know him from Green Acres. He also played Ollie Hockham in the 1955 film version of Oklahoma. So he and Ronald Graham were the identical twins, Antipholus, and Jimmy Salvo and Teddy Hart, Lorenz Hart's brother, played the slave twins. There was also a film version of The Boys from Syracuse, stage version 1938, the film version in 1940 featured Martha Ray. Here is Martha Ray with that well-known large mouth. The movie version did not get great reviews. One New Yorker commented that the film had revived the stage musical not very successfully. I love this quote from somebody who reviewed it on Amazon. The brilliant score by Rodgers and Hart is bent out of shape, truncated and sidelined, and what made for depressing shtick from the usually reliable cast of character actors from the 1930s, who in this instance can't bring any life to the proceedings. If there's anything to recommend here, it would be the 15 minutes or so of music vaguely resembling the original. This was quite common. So we've now seen two musicals, The Boys from Syracuse and Strike Up the Band, that were both converted into film musicals shortly after their staged productions, that had very little to do, were quite different from the stage version. And it was part of the reason that Rodgers and Hammerstein had cited for retaining all the total control for their film version of Oklahoma. So Oklahoma was on the stage in 1943. The 1955 film was, again, Rodgers and Hammerstein maintained complete control over. They didn't want the studios making adaptations and interpolating songs from other composers into the work, which was so common for the time. I'm going to play another beautiful song from this this show. This is the song "This Can't Be Love," and we're going to listen to Nat King Cole singing it from his 1957 television show. "This Can't Be Love," Nat King Cole.
"Because I feel so well, no sorrows, no sorrows, no sighs. This can't be love. I get no dizzy spell. My head is not in the sky. My heart does not stand still. Just hear it beat. This is too sweet to be loved. This can't be love. Because I feel so well, but still I love to look in your eyes. My heart does not stand still, just hear it beat. This is too sweet to be loved."
There, at least we heard a little bit of the song "This Can't Be Love" from Nat King Cole. The New York World Telegram, in reviewing the show, said this will be regarded as the greatest musical comedy of its time. Another reviewer wrote, "The fact that The Boys from Syracuse boasts so many standards isn't what's astonishing. What is astonishing is the melodic invention, the musicianship, theatricality, harmonic surprises, and even the mischievousness to be found in the score and its musical arrangements." Really are some lovely songs. We'll hear a couple of more. This next song is from a 1999 PBS special on Rodgers and Hart. The song is "Sing for Your Supper" with Rebecca Luker, Debbie Shapiro Gravett, and Christine Ebersole singing.
"Hawks and crows do lots of things,
but the canary only sings.
She is a
all the canary knows is song,
but the canary gets a
amazing, amazing music in this show. And it's just like one incredible song after another. We're next going to hear the actress Sierra Bogus singing Falling in Love with Love. This is a BBC proms concert from 2012. Falling in Love with Love.
Merry maids can sew and sing. Wives can only sew and weep. Falling in love with love is falling for make-believe. Falling in love with love is playing the fool. Caring too much is such a juvenile fancy. Learning to trust is just for children in school. I fell in love with love one night when the moon was full.
Lovely, lovely song. They wrote lots of love songs, and this show certainly is full of them. But there's a lot of comedy in the show also. We're going to listen to one last clip, and this is a song called What Can You Do With a Man? It's taken from a 1986 Ontario Stratford Festival TV broadcast. It's not great musical quality. The video, I'm sorry, is not great quality. The audio is fine. It's performed by Keith Thomas and Susan Wright. Keith is playing Dromio from Ephesus, and Susan is playing his wife.
Listen to your lover who asks why this battle has begun.
He has long neglected some tasks that a husband should have done. He eats me out of house and home, but doesn't like my cooking. That's nothing new with a man. What can you do with a man? He likes to use my brush and comb, and yet he's funny looking. Homes like a zoo with a man. What can you do with a man? I bought the guy pajamas. I took a chance. Some men wear half pajamas. He wears the pants. By day he's like a five-year-old. At night he's 97. What can you do with a man like that?
When you get mad, don't count to 10. Go on and count a million. Don't be a shrew with a man. That's what you do with a man. You need a regiment of men. I'm only one civilian. Wait for your cue with a man. That's what you do with a man. Marriage is such a blessing, so I have found. I've got a thousand blessings, each weighs a pound.
So that's the boys from Syracuse. And again, full of wonderful, wonderful songs. And I will pause. And Sarah, if we have any questions, or if not, I'll move on to our next show.
I believe you are good. I am, just so you guys know, I am pulling some of the albums for links, and I'll be able to share that after the program tonight.
Okay. Well, we will
continue. I think you're good to go on.
There we go. Our next show, Irving Berlin's Miss Liberty from 1949. Irving Berlin wrote lots of shows. He was sort of unusual for his time in that he wrote both the music and the lyrics. Again, not that common. Stage works listed on the left of this slide from his 1914 Watch Your Step all the way to Mr. President, 1962. Miss Liberty is one of his later shows. I think part of its problem was it followed on the super successful Annie Get Your Gun. So there was tremendous anticipation for another Annie Get Your Gun when Miss Liberty premiered. Irving Berlin is known for his writing songs in what is called the American vernacular. They're uncomplicated, simple, and direct songs. He had a stated aim of trying to reach the heart of the average American. He was born to a Russian Jewish family, and his family immigrated to New York City when he was just a couple of years old. His father was a cantor, which is where Irving learned music. He was self-taught and taught by his father. He dropped out of school at age 15 and sang on the streets of New York and got involved with Tin Pan Alley. His first Tin Pan Alley hit was 1911 Alexander's Ragtime Band. Irving Berlin, as we talked about in Broadway by the Decades, was an extraordinarily prolific songwriter, writing some 1,500 songs, including standards like There's No Business Like Show Business, Putting on the Ritz, White Christmas. He was also deeply patriotic. We heard in the Broadway by the Decades talk his song, Oh, How I Hate to Get Up in the Morning. He also wrote God Bless America and was given several national awards for his patriotism, a Congressional Gold Medal, the Presidential Medal of Freedom, Medal of Liberty. He won an Academy Award for the song White Christmas, three Tony Awards, and a Grammy Lifetime Achievement Award. Competition for Miss Liberty, though it opened in July of 1949, perhaps not a great time to be opening when you're competing against shows like Kiss Me Kate, South Pacific, Gentlemen Prefer Blondes. Kiss Me Kate got five Tony Awards in 1949, including the very first musical to win the Tony Award for Best Musical. South Pacific won the second Tony Award for Best Musical in 1950. They were both, again, extraordinarily successful shows that far outclipsed Miss Liberty. Miss Liberty starred Eddie Albert. Eddie, as we talked about, was the star of the previous show as well. So a name that is, and we'll hear other names in the context of this show, Miss Liberty, that we've talked about earlier in the show is in this presentation as well. 1949 was sort of a curious time as well, that World War II was kind of winding down while fighting had started. We were still living in the long shadow of World War II. There were still some outstanding business related to the war. And there was this tremendous scare of communism. So the Cold War was alive and well. NATO was being created. The United Nations was still getting started. The concern about the Red Scare is indicated by the conviction of a number of 11 leaders of the American Communist Party and the FBI starting to name suspected communist party members and communist sympathizers, including a lot of folks in the entertainment industry. A lot was happening in radio and TV as well. So a time of tremendous change, patriotism and concern about the future of the world as well. The book and libretto for this show, Miss Liberty, was written by Robert Sherwood, who is a very complex character as well. He claims his motivation for this was seeing American GIs being shipped overseas, looking at the Statue of Liberty as their ships were leaving New York, and how profoundly seeing the statue impacted them. He wanted to write a show about this great symbol of freedom. And in fact, the story of Miss Liberty is about the sculpting of the Statue of Liberty in the 1880s. Sherwood was also an author, speechwriter, playwriter, historian, and screenwriter. Winner of four Pulitzer Prizes. He collaborated with Alfred Hitchcock, wrote the screenplay for The Best Years of Our Lives. That the theme there and many of his other works was kind of the futility of war and the high cost of war. He himself was a World War I veteran, also an anti-war activist. Oddly, he ended up as FDR's speechwriter during World War II and became the director of the U.S. Office of War Information for a time as well. So kind of complicated because he was both a pacifist or anti-war activist and was deeply involved in kind of the propaganda and information side of World War II. I found this quote from Sherwood, which I think really adequately fits for Miss Liberty as well. The trouble with me is that I start with a big message, like the profound impact of the Statue of Liberty on those GIs, but he ends up with nothing but good entertainment in the end. And this is not a highly political show. It very much was musical comedy as well, although it was inspired by this, uh, this you know, very, very patriotic symbol, the Statue of Liberty. I think the patriotism is perhaps best shown and mostly linked to this a song in the show, Give Me Your Tired, Your Poor, that is from this poem, The New Colossus, which is engraved on a brass plaque that sits at the base of the Statue of Liberty. It was written by a lady, Emma Lazarus, in 1883. She had written the poem for an auction to raise money for the base of the Statue of Liberty. And Irving Berlin has set to music this highlighted part of the poem, and we will next hear that. The song, Give Me Your Tired, Your Poor. In this clip, it starts with Irving Berlin singing the song, and then we switch to a chorus from Arizona, the Carolyn Inyon Singers, singing the rest of the song.
Give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses yearning to breathe free, the wretched refuse of your teeming shore. Send these, the homeless tempest tossed, to me. I lift my lamp beside the golden.
Very common choral number for schools to be singing during the 1950s as well. And looking this up, I found reference after reference of folks saying, oh yes, we sang that. And there are lots of choral recordings of that as well. The plot of the show, again, we're set in 1885. Eddie Albert, shown there with the camera, is a young reporter for a New York City newspaper. He has an American girlfriend named Maisie Dahl. Horace's new work assignment is to find the woman who served as the model for the Statue of Liberty, Miss Liberty. He then travels to the studio of the Paris sculptor, and the actual studio of the sculptor who made the Statue of Liberty is shown in the upper right of this slide as well. Once there, the character Horace Miller sees a picture of a model in the sculptor's studio. The model's name is Monique DuPont, and he mistakenly believes that she was the model for the statue. He brings Monique back to New York, where she becomes a media darling. It later turns out she's discovered as not being the model after all, and she faces great scorn and is threatened with deportation until a newspaper bigwig steps in, saves the day, allows her to stay in the United States. Horace then jilts his American girlfriend, Maisie Dahl, in favor of Monique, the French beauty. So not exactly a super patriotic show, but it was inspired by the Statue of Liberty. Let's listen to Eddie Albert's big love song. This is, the song is called Just One Way to Say I Love You.
Oh, why search for flowery phrases? Quoting what poets have said, why talk in circles around it? Why not be simple instead? Let's hit the nail on the head. I love you, just one way to say I love you. I love you, I love you. And try as I may, that's all I can say. I love you. Much more could be said if I thought with my head, but I only can think with my heart.
But Eddie Albert's born name was Eddie Albert Heimberger. He gave up the Heimbergers, claiming that it sounded too much like hamburger. He was born in Illinois in 1906, attended college at the University of Minnesota, and graduated right at the start of the Great Depression. He then worked as a trapeze artist and had a number of other odd jobs before landing a job in radio in New York, which got him some notoriety, a film contract before he moved to Broadway and started a number of shows. After the show, he actually took over in a music man for Robert Preston in 1960. So he had quite a run on Broadway as well. The other members of the creative team included direction by Moss Hart. Moss Hart, another New Yorker, frequent collaborator of George Kaufman, we talked about. He won a Pulitzer Prize for his You Can't Take It With You, turned into the Frank Capra film. Got a Tony Award for directing My Fair Lady. Choreography for the show was by Jerome Robbins, born in New York City, 1918. Producer, director, dancer, choreographer. Again, we talked a little bit about the politics and the Red Scare. Jerome Robbins was a victim of some of that as well. In 1950, so the year after Miss Liberty, he was called to testify before the House Committee on Un-American Activities as a suspected communist sympathizer. He refused to collaborate and to testify initially. The committee threatened to out him as a homosexual. And he finally relented and did collaborate with them in the end. And because he collaborated, they say his career wasn't really terribly impacted. A year after Miss Liberty, Eddie Albert as well was listed as a potential communist sympathizer. His name appeared in a list of, he and his wife both, their names appeared as possible sympathizers of the Communist Party. He was a World War II decorated soldier for rescuing several Marines during an attack in the Pacific. And his family believes that was the reason that he was eventually let off because of his war record. So this idea of liberty and the scare after World War II certainly was very much alive and well for the cast and creative team for this production. I'll play you another song. This is kind of a funny song for an older character actress. It is, in this case, sung by the woman Ethel Griffies, who is an English actress, who is perhaps best known not as a singer, but as playing the ornithologist, the elderly ornithologist in Alfred Hitchcock's 1963 movie, The Birds. Here she is singing to Eddie Albert, Only for Americans.
Not the Follies, Berger!
No, 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 no. They are only for Americans. The midnight life of gay Paris, the Frenchman he would never see, that's only for Americans. The price is in the smart cafe, the Frenchman he would never pay. The price that's more is only for Americans from the USA. A Montmartre lady drops her hanky and slyly winks her eye. That's only for the Yankee, the Frenchman wouldn't buy. Only for Americans. The Frenchmen on the boulevards don't buy those dirty postal cards. They're only for Americans. The little holes for peeping through to see what naughty people do. The French would bore. They're only for Americans from the USA. Only for Americans. The shops with many real antiques, antiques as old as 7 weeks, are only for Americans. The bed on which a king made love, which there are several dozens of. The French, we sell them to Americans from the USA. We buy your
Stop her there. I'm going to play one last selection from this musical. And this is a song sung between the two love interests of Eddie Albert, the reporter, his American and his French girlfriends, played by Alan McCleary and Mary McCarty. The song is called You Can't Have Him.
Maisie, you don't care what happens to Horace and me as long as you get him. You're in love with him.
Oh, no, I'm not.
Oh, yes, you are.
No, I'm not. You can have him. I don't want him. He's not worth fighting for. Besides, there's plenty more where he came from. I don't want him. You can have him. I'm giving him the sack. And he can go right back where he came from. I could never make him happy. He'd be better off with you. I'm afraid I never loved him. All I ever wanted to do was run my fingers through his curly locks, mend his underwear and darn his socks, fetch his slippers and remove his shoes, wipe his glasses when he read the news, rub his forehead with a gentle touch, mornings after when he'd had too much, kiss him gently when he cuddled near, give him babies, one for every year. So you see, you can have him. I don't want him. I don't want him. You can have him, for he's not the man for me.
So that's it for music from that incredible show. Not super well received, although the songs from it became very popular hits. There are lots of singles of many of the songs from this show. The critics, again, were anticipating another Annie Get Your Gun, and this was not an Annie Get Your Gun. New York Post described it as only pretty fair. New York Times, disappointing. New York Sun, sharp disappointment. Variety, an overly plotty book, undistinguished score, insufficient comedy, and merely adequate performances, something of a clinker. So again, not great reviews, but the songs certainly made it into the popular realm with lots of recordings of them. And here we have a list of the songs. And again, I've highlighted those that we have heard. And I'll pause again, Sarah, if there are questions. And if not, I'll jump into Out of This World. And I realize I'm running late.
That is fine. No, we've got no questions yet. And yeah, out of this, take us out of this world.
I love this. Cole Porter's 1950 show, Out of This World. Cole Porter, like Irving Berlin, was another one of these guys that did his music and lyrics all by his lonesome. He's described as one of the wittiest of all the lyricists. Born in 1989 in Indiana, only child of a mother who doted on him. His maternal grandfather, James Omar Cole, was described as the richest man in Indiana. He certainly dominated the family and had aspirations for his grandson, Cole, to become an important lawyer. Although Cole Porter attended Yale and then started law school at Harvard, he left to pursue a career in music. That's where his real heart was. He had gotten some initial success in the 1920s and 30s, but his work and his work continues to stand. It's described as an epitome of sophistication, civilized detachment of the popular song form. He has a reputation for being too sophisticated for national popularity, however. He himself is quoted as saying, "Sophisticated illusions are good for about 6 weeks, more fun, but only for myself and about 18 other people, all of whom were first-nighters anyway. Polished, urbane, and adult playwriting in the musical field is strictly a creative luxury." He had a bad riding accident, a horse riding accident in the mid-30s, which left him in terrible pain for a long while. And people thought he was sort of washed up until he had Kiss Me, Kate, which became wildly successful. The first ever winner of the Tony Award for best musical and best original score. So great, great success with Kiss Me, Kate. And like we had just talked about with Irving Berlin, his next show, Out of the World, had tremendous amount of, there was tremendous anticipation for this being another Kiss Me, Kate. It is based on a work by this ancient Roman playwright, again, kind of typical of Cole Porter, who was very much a history and classics buff as well, and worked a lot of that interest into his shows. Staging and choreography was by Agnes DeMille, whom we've talked about before. She was the choreographer for the film version of Oklahoma. She won a Tony Award for Brigadoon, choreography of Brigadoon in 1947. There was so much anticipation for the show Out of This World, following on the heels of Kiss Me, Kate, that CBS radio was even broadcasting the songs from Out of This World before it even opened. In interviews, and Doris Day and Joe Stafford were singing some of the highlights of the song. So our first selection here, we're going to listen to Joe Stafford singing the song, Use Your Imagination.
Use your imagination, just take this motto for your theme, and soon every night will be crowded with delight, and every day will be a dream.
Beautiful song. Out of This World, again, 1950, it was competing with a number of shows. Again, Rodgers and Hammerstein, right, top of the stack here, South Pacific, Gentlemen Prefer Blondes, Call Me Madam, Guys and Dolls, The King and I, a lot of competition, which would make it very difficult for another show to succeed. And so that has been part of the challenge with Out of the World. The plot of Out of This World is, again, based on that ancient Roman play, and it revolves around mythological gods, Jupiter or Zeus, who's kind of the head god from Greek or Roman mythology, is a notorious womanizer. He doesn't know the meaning of fidelity to his wife, Juno. Juno was played by Charlotte Greenwood, shown here. The play Out of This World is set in 1950s Greece, however. Those ancient Greek gods are still around, though, and they're still interfering in the lives of mankind. So in 1950s Greece, there's a newlywed couple, an American newspaper man and his wife, who are honeymooning in Greece. And while there, the newspaper man is trying to get an interview with this well-known Greek gangster. While he's chasing the newspaper man, Jupiter, the head god, is lusting after and chasing after the American bride. Juno, Jupiter's wife, is justifiably suspicious of Jupiter because he's always chasing women. So she's chasing after her husband, Jupiter. Jupiter, meanwhile, enlists the help of the god Mercury to help him in his conquest of the American bride and also to detract Juno from catching him. Mercury, for those of you that may not remember your mythology, was the god of commerce, messages, trickery, and thieves. While he's helping Jupiter, his dad, he's not beyond having some fun of his own with mortal women. So there's lots of love and lots of lust in this show, Out of This World. It, true to Cole Porter's wittiness of lyrics, we'll share with you some of the lyrics from the song we'll play next. The song is sung by the god Mercury, who is singing to a young Greek maiden that he is trying to seduce. And I'll just read you the lyrics. We'll hear them next, though. After snitching Eve from Adam, my attendant called me Madam, and shortly began to nestle Ethel Merman. There was Galatea, mean Medea, and Sappho, one of the best. There was Nefertiti, a perfect sweetie, and gay Mae West. I was a hell of a fellow with Cinderella and Isabella of Spain, and I used to caress both Lola Montez and that damn Calamity Jane. Lots and lots of references to classical classical characters, theater characters, and people from popular culture as well. And just he kind of rattles them off in lightning speed, which is kind of a trademark from Cole Porter as well, and very much in the frame of songs of lists that we talked about during the Broadway by the Decades lectures as well. Let's hear the song They Couldn't Compare to You, sung by George Abed. This is sung in a nightclub, it looks like, from 2015.
Oh, ladies fair, I'm loved more than my share. Sirens who resided in my environs, I decided to learn the art of Cupid's trickery. So at once I started cruising, found the muses so amusing that I even got a kick out of terpsichore. After that I met Calypso, who was definitely a dipso. Then I fled to Big Brunhilde, she was German. After snitching Eve from Adam, I attended Call Me Madam, and shortly began to nestle Esselmerman. I admired the silken body of the Sheik Scheherazade, and of Lady Godiva I became the Lord. For some friends of Lucretia Borgia, and ended up at the store with Fanny Ward. After having had a party with Phoenicia's goddess Astarte, while I raised a bit of hell with Penelope. After quieting all my urchins for several Vestal virgins, I put on a strip for Gypsy Rosalie. Though I liked the Queen of Sheba, she was mentally an amoeba. As for Beatrice Desti, she was a pest, far too chesty, to the passionate wife of Nero. My reaction was frankly zero. As that sorceress known as Circe, she was so hot, I hollered for mercy. Ah, there was Galatea and Mean Medea and Sappho, one of the best. There was Nefertiti, a perfect sweetie and gay Mae West. I was a hell of a fellow with Cinderella and Isabella of Spain. And I used to caress both of them on test.
And we're not just listening to him. Out of This World is described as one of Cole Porter's loveliest scores. A critic wrote, Out of This World is his loveliest score in an odd sort of way. All mature Porter scores, have their tender side and their sassy side. This score is the tenderest, but also the sassiest. It is portissimo. What went wrong with the show? One of the co-producers later commented the score was better than the score of Kiss Me, Kate, but they never quite got the book right. Another critic mentioned that it lacked the new standard of an integrated score and felt more like a review-style show of 10 years earlier. The pre-show, pre-Broadway runs in Philadelphia and in Boston had a lot of chaos. There were problems with the production team, a lot of casting changes. There were cuts and rewrites to the show. There was a lot of criticism even during the pre-Broadway runs as well. One wrote, although it's difficult to make sex a tiresome subject, Out of This World has very nearly succeeded. In Boston, the mayor objected to the show and its irreverent use of God. He claimed that the costumes, dances, and lyrics were all way too suggestive. One critic wrote, Jupiter's opening number is eruditely hot. The music goes all horny. Staging, as I mentioned earlier, was by Agnes DeMille. She was replaced by George Abbott, who was the director for Boys of Syracuse, as we talked about earlier, before the show even made it to Broadway. George Abbott threw out what is perhaps the most famous song from the show because he claimed the actors couldn't do it justice. That song, From This Moment On, we'll now hear Doris Day singing. This is a 1950 recording of Doris Day, this from This Moment On.
From this moment on, you for me, dear, only two for tea, dear, from this moment on, from this happy day. From this moment on, for you've got the skin I love to touch. You've got the arms to hold me tight. You've got the sweet lips to kiss me goodnight.
Okay, thank you, Doris Day.
We can't talk about Out of This World without talking more about Charlotte Greenwood, nicknamed Daddy or Lady Longlegs. Charlotte Greenwood, born 1890 in Philadelphia, you might recognize her as Aunt Eller from the 1955 film Oklahoma. She was a star on vaudeville before moving to Broadway, radio, and movies. She was 6 feet tall and best known for her long legs and high kicks. In her own words, she was the only woman in the world who could kick a giraffe in the eye. Critics described her as her performance as warm-hearted clowning. She throws her head back when she plunges into a song. She moves around the stage in a sort of grotesque crouch. So kind of a clown on stage. Charlotte Greenwood was also a devout Christian Scientist. Later in her career, she was known for rejecting roles that she thought were too risque. And even with Out of This World, with all of its sexual innuendos, and she had some discomfort with the show as well. And you kind of wonder whether that had some contribution to the lack of success for the show as well. We'll end with two final selections featuring the Charlotte Greenwood character Juno. The first is from the original cast recording. It is Juno, the American bride, and the young woman that the god Mercury is trying to seduce, singing the song, What Do You Think About Men? And then we'll end with the song, I Sleep Easier Now. It's a solo by the character Juno. It is, however, from the 1995 cast recording, sung by Andrea Martin. So two more song selections, and those will be our final selections for the evening.
Men, 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 always around when you don't want them, always underfoot, morning, noon, and night.
What do you think about men?
What do I think about men?
Oh, men are dreamy, men are sweet. They simply knock me off my feet. They're so enchanting, so much fun, and I just can't wait until I marry one. That's what I think about men.
That's what you think about men.
What do you think about men?
What do I think about men?
Oh, men are only naughty boys, and we to them are merely toys. They're always up to some new prank, and I know of one that Mama'd love to spank. That's what I think about men.
That's what you think about men.
What do you think about men?
What do I think about men?
Oh, men are just a pair of pants. They're always after fresh romance. In search of fun, they run about, and they don't come home until they're all run out. That's what I think about men.
That's what you think about men.
We are absolutely certain as to what we think of men.
But when night doth draw her curtain, and the hour approacheth ten,
when the moon is o'er the mountain, and there's mischief in the glen,
no matter what we think about men, we think about men.
And the last...
Poets always speak of youth with such admiration, but we all must face the truth, age has many a compensation. When I was younger, when I was younger, for nightlife I used to hunger. I sleep easier now. When I was cuter, when I was cuter, each night meant a different suitor. I sleep easier now. In the olden days at 10 p.m. I'd be necking in a hack. But this evening when it's 10 p.m. you will find me hitting the sack. When I was snappier, when I was snappier, I made lots of boyfriends happier. I sleep
easier now. I sleep easier now.
So there we have it. Those are our selections from Out of This World. Here's a complete song list of the show's songs, including From This Moment On, that was cut from the show.
So we've talked about four different musicals by these amazing creative teams, the Gershwins, Rodgers and Hart, Irving Berlin, and Cole Porter. Each of these songs has some incredible music, and in their own ways all brought innovation to musical theater as well, even though they weren't great successes for the most part. Of these, perhaps Boys from Syracuse was the most successful, although it seems to a bit neglected in today's repertoire of what's on the stage. Happy to have a discussion. I know I've talked longer than I should have. I do have a couple of slides here with available recordings for each of the four shows. Strike Up the Band, both the 27 and the 1930 versions have been recorded by the same cast. A long lag in the times between the releases of the two versions, even though they were recorded at the same time, and then the 1940 film version. There have been a number of recordings of The Boys from Syracuse, and then Miss Liberty, there's only been the original cast recording Out of This World. Listen to a recording, this is with Charlotte Greenwood, the original cast recording, and then this 1995 New York City encore production as well. So I will stop, and Sarah, if you'd like to.
Awesome. Thank you, Ron. That was amazing. I ladies and gentlemen, I did pull links for YouTube, the albums on YouTube and Amazon and through Spotify. So I will be able to send that out. It is posted in the Facebook group. And then if you RSVP'd, or you can send me your email address, I'm happy to send those links out to you as needed. So Laura did have a question about Out of This World, and she wondered, do you have any idea why they used the Roman gods' names when the story was set in Greece?
Well, the source material was a Roman book, and so it may have been that, may have been part of what Cole Porter was thinking as well, but don't know.
Yeah, artistic license is always. And I do invite you guys, anybody else that has any questions, Ron, they're praising you in the chat, as always, it was fabulous. If you do have any questions, do feel free to turn on your unmute yourself and undo your video, and please join us. We love to say hi and see faces. And thank you, Ron. That was.
I love these old shows, and as I said, part of the reason I started looking into them was listening to some of these standards, and Ella Fitzgerald in particular. Oh, what cool songs!
Yeah. I mean, there's tons. As I was browsing for albums, I came across, there's apparently a 1959 musical called Saratoga, and I don't know why we haven't done that. So. Something to look into for future. It is fascinating to go back and through. Tipu pointed out, so many of these old classic American songbook songs just have their basis in musicals. There were no, rights were looser back then. Thank you.
Well, everybody wanted to record them after they were on stage as well. And so many of them became very popular songs.
Right. Absolutely. Otherwise, you guys, and let's see, anybody else with any questions or comments they want to? Yeah, Tipu, I did think that too, that they were probably talking about New York. And so, but you know what? Whatever. We know.
Saratoga, New York. Yeah.
With the cool, I have been looking. I was unable to find the scripts. That was something that I was trying to hunt down. So I will, if I find them, I will somehow share. But that has been hard.
But as I was talking with Sarah about, some of these shows have undergone a lot of surgery to kind of put them together, to update them. And you have shows like Strike Up the Band where there were two very different versions. And so which is the definitive version, and people have tried to splice the two together, and that, yeah, it may be that there's not one standard out there necessarily.
It is absolutely, absolutely possible that that is, that there, you know, I guess it would be one that to look at the rights houses and see there must be, because yeah, and no, at least Boys of Syracuse was somewhere on a list for us to consider fairly recently within the past couple of years. Although the other ones now, I'm more curious. It really does pique the curiosity.
Good.
Yeah.
Amazing show. I see a question here about the cheesemaker, and I don't know if that's a strike up the band question.
Kathy, do you want to pop on?
I just think that it's high time that we have a musical on stage with a cheesemaker in the major role.
I would agree with that.
I can get behind that.
There's, you know, we have somebody who maybe has not made his onstage debut that should play that cheesemaker, but I don't know if he would be willing.
And so there's some really funny lines in that, the strike up the band and the kind of the cheese wars, right? Swiss cheese versus American cheese. It's really very goofy.
There's so many good cheese jokes, really.
In that one, the reporter who falls in love with the daughter of the cheesemaker, and they're having this battle because he's saying the cheese is not any good. And she's, how can you say that? I don't want to go to war. She's, how can you say that? And he says, I don't even like cheese. And she said, well, I can't love you then.
Oh.
Interestingly, when they redid the show, the 1930 version has him as a chocolate maker instead of a cheese maker. And so why they changed that is beyond me.
You know, you could really do a whole thing with this, and there could be cheese at intermission. We could have wine.
I like it.
Well, I guess we can't have wine at the Civic Theater, but boy, we could do some cheese pairings beforehand.
Definitely.
Cheese is much funnier than chocolate.
Cheese is more funny.
Well, I can see the bad cheese jokes coming too.
It was super cheesy.
Not good enough?
Not good enough. I'm sure there's plenty more that aren't coming to my head. Otherwise, that's all I've got to say. Thank you all for coming. Ron, thank you so much for joining us.
Well, thank you for giving me the opportunity to share with you and share my love for these old shows. I think they're just a hoot. I love listening to them.
They are absolutely great. And I'm definitely inspired to pull out maybe some underappreciated gems for sure. I have to see what the Saratoga is like. But that's it, you guys. I'm going to go ahead and once again say thank you all for joining us. We will see you soon. And I'm turning it off.
Ooh. Thank you. Good night.
Good night, you guys. Thanks.